Let's look at another question. Are you equally yoked? So first, what does that mean in a marriage?
This is a that phrase, equally yoked, is a biblical phrase, and it doesn't always translate into our culture. So if someone is familiar with the Bible or if they were raised in church, they've probably heard this phrase before. If they haven't, it's a real simple idea to understand. It is a phrase taken off of the farm. When a farmer would plow a piece of property, he had two animals, usually an ox or two oxen. And those oxen would be bound together by a yoke. And a yoke was a very strong and heavy wooden beam that was actually placed on the backs of the necks of these two oxen. So wherever one went, the other one had to go. Well, the Apostle Paul in the New Testament is writing to the church in Corinth. And that church was really confused about sex and marriage and relationships. It was a sex-saturated and sex-crazed culture. And people just did not know how to have healthy relationships. And so the Apostle Paul is giving a word of caution to the Christians in this very wicked city of Corinth. And he says to this church in the book of 2 Corinthians, do not be unequally yoked with unbelievers. In other words, don't be tied in marriage to someone who doesn't share the same convictions and beliefs that you do. Now, this doesn't mean that as a Christian, we think we're better than people who aren't Christians. It doesn't mean that we take a high seat of judgment and that we look down our noses on people like that. Unfortunately, a lot of people think, well, if I'm a Christian, who am I to judge? But you're not judging somebody. You're looking at a person that you might be attracted to. And you're thinking, I like this person. Maybe I want to marry them. Maybe the most essential spiritual question you're ever going to ask is, but are they a Christian? Are we going in the same direction spiritually? Because if we don't believe the same thing about God, the Bible, eternity, right and wrong, heaven and hell, then we're going to have a really tough time making marriage work. I mean, it's really important that you agree on the most essential issues of your own personal convictions and beliefs. So a lot of people will object and say, well, I'm a Christian and they may not be a Christian. Maybe I can lead them to Christ. And I appreciate that. And that's a helpful thing to think, but it almost never works out that way. It's easier for someone that is not governed by the Holy Spirit, that doesn't live according to the Bible. It's easier for someone who is not a Christian to pull a Christian down than it is for a Christian to pull a non-believer up. We can still have friendships with non-believers. We should. We should still live in the world where people don't know Christ so that we can be a testimony to the gospel and a witness to them. But we're not talking here at this time about being a witness to your coworkers and about sharing the gospel with people that don't know Jesus. We're talking about the person you marry. And when you're going to make the biggest commitment of your life, you want to make sure that the person you're looking to marry agrees with you and that you agree with them on the most essential spiritual elements of belief. If you don't ask this question up front, you make big assumptions about what you think that person believes. And then what happens when you've been married for a year and there's a disagreement about whether or not you'll go to church on Sunday anymore? What if there's a disagreement about whether or not you'll tithe 10% of your income to your local congregation? Then you have children. What happens when your children are born and you have to try to fight and decide, are we going to raise our kids in church? What about when your kids grow up and get a little older and they're playing baseball or soccer or some sport? And church is on Sunday, but their games are on Sunday, and you have to have that fight. If you agree on the essentials of your faith, then you already are on the same page when you get married. You want to have that question out on the table long before you tie the knot, or if you've already tied the knot early on in your marriage. Because what Paul says in that passage of Scripture is that light and darkness don't mix. And when Christ lives in us, then we want to share the most intimate relationship in life with another person that belongs to Jesus. And that's why my wife and I believe, have such a great marriage. Again, not perfect, but we both belong to Jesus, and we belong to Him before we belong to each other.